I want to invite you to go ahead and take your copy of God's Word and be turning to the book of James as we finish out chapter 4 this morning, continuing in our study here in practical faith, what it looks like to take our theology and not just hold it in our heads, but actually practice it, actually do our theology. And I confess this morning, I've read through this passage many times, and even in preparing the message, this one hits deep for me, but it hits me in an area where I feel like here's a struggle. We're going to talk about not leaving the Lord out of our plans, making plans and kind of going through the rhythms and routines of our life. I'm a big time planner. Maybe some of you are a little bit like me. You like to make plans in life, and not only do you like to make plans, but you like to stick to a plan. Amen. Some of you are like that. Others of you, look, I get it. You kind of fly by the seat of your pants. I get that. I don't get you. I don't understand that. That doesn't work for me. But I will confess this, I'm a planner because I like to feel organized and in control of my life, right? Here's where the struggle is. I want to feel organized, I want to feel in control of my life, but yet the older I get, the more I realize that that's a little bit of a fool's errand. It's not always possible. You can't be completely in control of your life. I mean, I remember seasons of life like almost 20 years ago when we moved off to seminary with a young child, and we realized we're going to be dirt poor for the next few years. And so, you know, we made the decision, we're going to put off having any more children until seminary's done. And a year later, I had this wonderful little boy in my arms. You know, God just doesn't work according to my schedule sometimes. There are things like that. A couple of years ago, I'm finishing up the dreaded journey of my dissertation, and I'm like two-thirds of the way through, and I'm blazing to the finish line thinking, here it is, we're going to make it, this is finally going to be done. And then I have to go in for surgery, and I'm missing meetings with my committee members, and then 2 weeks later, I'm in the worst accident of my life, and I'm like, Lord, what's going on here? This isn't my plan. This isn't how I organized everything. I didn't plan it this way. And I certainly didn't plan for COVID in 2020 or in 2021. It wasn't on my long-term plans. It wasn't in my 5-year plan. Didn't have it planned that way. You probably have your own list of things that you've planned that just didn't quite work out that way. Didn't quite go the way you thought it would. And listen, my point this morning is not to say there's anything wrong with planning. I think that's good and appropriate. As you read through the book of Acts, as we've been doing in our Bible reading plan, you can't help but notice time after time, the Apostle Paul and others, they're making these plans and they're kind of being organized and strategic in the way that they go about the missionary journeys that they're on. But you also notice that sometimes the Lord says, no, that's not what I have for you. Sometimes he changes the plan with a Macedonian call. Sometimes he changes the plan with an imprisonment or a beating. And he changes things. And that's okay. That's all right. That's not a problem. The problem, though, is not when we plan or try to make plans. The problem is when our planning stems from a prideful heart. And that's really at the heart of what we're talking about this morning. You might recall that James, several times now in this letter, has addressed a particular subset of his audience, namely the wealthy people, the rich. And now we may not feel like we identify with the rich and the wealthy, but hey, in America, most of us, we fit into that category, all right? So he's been addressing the rich a few times already in the letter, not because he hates them, and not because money in and of itself is evil, that's not the point, but he warns against some of the temptations that we deal with as our wealth increases. So like in chapter 1, we saw the warning against the temptation to boast in our wealth and possessions. Then in chapter 2, there was the temptation here to cater to or to show favoritism in the church. toward those with more means, more wealth, those who could do more for us in the church. And now in chapter 4, he's going to address another temptation, although not quite as explicitly. But we'll get to that in just a moment. But we're going to address another temptation here, this temptation to be self-reliant and a bit arrogant in the way that we plan out our lives. So with that in mind, with keeping the particular audience here in our mind, let's look at the text here in James chapter 4. And we're going to read verses 13 through 17 as we finish out the chapter. So under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, James writes this, verse 13. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. Amen? Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, as we open your word this morning, help us to position ourselves to sit under the authority of your word. And we pray that as we do that here during these next moments, that your spirit would speak your truth into our lives, not so that we merely know it, but so that we become doers of your word. We ask you to do that in our hearts and in our lives, in Jesus' name, amen. So when we think about what's taking place here, travel planning, making a profit, all the business interactions, all the things that he's referring to right away here in this passage, we get the impression that James has a particular audience in mind. He's talking about these wealthier, independence-minded, materialistic Christians. Remember, he's writing to the church here. But he has this particular group in mind. Now, as I said a moment ago, though, plans can be good. James isn't criticizing planning. He's simply saying there's something a bit idolatrous about setting the course of our lives with a worldly mindset rather than a focus on Christ and what he would have us do and the direction he might be leading us, which can be totally different than the way we think our life is going. It can be totally different from where we see ourselves in 10 years, 5 years, next year, or even next month. He's saying there's something idolatrous about that kind of a mindset. And the challenge for us then this morning is to spend less time obsessing over our life plans and where we think we need to be at some point in life based on a materialistic and self-focus, and spend more time giving our focus and attention to the one who is sovereign over all the endeavors of our life. You see, it's too easy to chart out our life course hoping that God will simply tag along and bless us in whatever we find to do, whatever we hope to do. God doesn't play tag along in our lives. He desires to lead. He desires to be at the forefront and focus of our plans. And so I want us to consider quickly here five truths about future planning with our eyes on Christ. And the first thing we notice here in the text is your planning may be self-centered. It may be. As we make plans, as we organize our lives, your planning may be self-centered. Now, James could be thinking of a specific situation here that he's addressing in verse 13, but probably he's just being very generic. He may not be thinking of a specific situation, but he has people in mind. He knows the sort of people that he's talking about here. And so we have this hypothetical case that verse 13 reveals to us. Let me read that again. He says, come now, you who say, and he quotes here this hypothetical situation, today or tomorrow we'll go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Now, notice all the planning that has gone into that. Notice what's going on here. You have not one of these days, Not, I hope to, Lord willing, one of these days, but no, today or tomorrow. There's a definite plan in place here, and they have the place already picked out. Now, again, it's hypothetical, so he doesn't list it for us, but they've got a place picked out, and they're going to go spend a year there, and they have a purpose when they get there. They're going to trade. They're going to do some business, and when you do business, you have one goal in mind. How is it going to turn out? He says, of course, you're going to make a profit. The goal is to make a profit. We're going to go here. We're going to do this. We're going to do it tomorrow or today or tomorrow, and we're going to make a profit. And everything is planned out here except one thing is glaringly missing from all of this planning. Christ has no place in it. He doesn't appear. There seems to be no deference to his leadership, to his guidance in their life. Now, again, James is writing to the church. He's writing to Christians here, but what he's saying is some of them aren't really acting like what they are. They're not living their lives according to what they are. Now, I want you to remember way back from the opening of this letter is written to Christians, to the church, in the dispersion. Do you remember that? They were scattered after the martyrdom of Stephen. There was a persecution that broke out, and so the church scattered to sort of all the areas around Judea and up into Asia. The church is scattered now. Persecution has hit, but it seems like maybe things are settling down a little bit. Things are getting a little bit easier now. These Christians have settled into new cities, and perhaps in these new cities for a season, the persecution has let up. And apparently what has happened is their hearts are now settling as well. And their hearts are turning more to financial gain and away from God, seemingly leaving him out of everything. Now, there's no rebuke here about seeking to make a profit, seeking to take care of your family, take care of your the needs of your family. There's no rebuke about that. The rebuke is for a worldly mindset of self-dependence. That's the rebuke. There's no rebuke here against planning for the future, having sort of this goal out there. Here's where we're aiming. Here's where we're going in life. No, there's no rebuke against that. James isn't saying you can't have life insurance and you got to get rid of your 401k or anything like that. He's not speaking to that. That's not the issue. The rebuke is for arrogant planning that leaves God out of the equation. That's a very self-centered outlook on life. In church, now here's the reality though. We don't just want to knock on these first century Christians, because the reality is times haven't really changed, have they? Times haven't really changed even in the church, and the problem is hearts haven't really changed either, and that's the dangerous part of all of this. And so the question that this puts before us right here at the beginning is, what does our planning say about us? What is our planning strategy for life? Is it self-focused? Is it about materialism? Getting as much as I can, as quick as I can, for as long as I can in life? Or is it Christ-centered? And even if it means plans don't go according to the way I thought they might, they go according to the way Christ wanted them, and I would gladly follow that because I want to glorify Christ rather than glorify self. You know, here in this country that we live in, we have a lot of freedom to plan and pretty much do as we please. I mean, the sky's the limit, we're often told. We can do anything that we want to do. But just like these in the early church, we're living in sin when we don't ask, how will my plans honor the Lord? I'm getting ready to make a move in my life. Will this move honor the Lord? Will it help me better honor Christ? I'm going to switch jobs. I'm going to switch careers. But will this career help me honor Christ? Or is it just about making more, having more stuff? Again, we need to ask, how will my plans honor the Lord? You know, we're living in sin when we don't seek out His will and seek out the Spirit's guidance for our life. You know what the great error of these first century Christians was? I mean, if we really had to kind of distill it down to one thing, the problem is they're being practical atheists. Part of the church, in the church, claiming Christ as Lord, but practically they're living as atheists. In other words, living their life as if God doesn't exist or care about what they do in life. That's practical atheism. That's the way the world lives. That's the way your atheist neighbor lives, as if God doesn't exist and doesn't care about what goes on in their life. Well, here's the deal. Jesus has no intention of merely being our consultant in life. We go about our plans, do our thing, and occasionally we're like, Jesus, I'm a little confused here. What do you think I should do? He doesn't just want to be the guy we give a quick call to every once in a while, that consultant in our life to check in when we feel the need. He's the sovereign Lord who sits above all the endeavors of mankind, including mine, including yours. So we need to be really, really careful here. Your planning, my planning, may be self-centered. And now here's why all of this is a bit sinful in our lives, or can be a bit sinful. The problem is, we look secondly here this morning, your future cannot be known. Now, of course, not from God's perspective. He knows the end from the beginning. But from our perspective, right, our future cannot be known. So how many times have you said to yourself, you know what, I'll do that tomorrow. You have something that needs to be done at home, something in your job, something in the family, but I'll do that tomorrow. And of course, the assumption is there will be a tomorrow. And of course, the additional assumption is that if there is a tomorrow, we know we're going to have time to do that. We know everything's going to kind of open up for us to be able to do that thing that we've put off until tomorrow. But what about tomorrow? Do we really know tomorrow? I mean, I've been waiting on tomorrow for a while. My wife bought me this wonderful fishing kayak for Father's Day. And I've had like tomorrow plans to take that out on the water for the last 2 months. And it wasn't till Friday that I actually got to take it out for the very first time. Why? Because I didn't know what tomorrow was going to bring. I had no idea. I had all these plans, but then tomorrow kept interrupting those plans. Because I'm not omniscient. I don't know what's coming. The words of Scripture ring true in verse 14. You do not know what tomorrow will bring. We think we do. Sometimes it turns out that way, but we don't know what tomorrow will bring. You see, you and I are merely flesh. We're merely created beings with limited knowledge, and none of us knows what the future is going to hold. And if we're being honest and we think back through our lives, there are plenty of instances in each one of our lives that bear that truth out. We didn't know what tomorrow was bringing. We don't know what tomorrow will be like. Proverbs 19:21 puts it this way, many are the plans in the mind of a man, and I say amen, absolutely, right? But it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand. It's not my purpose. It's not my plans. It's the purpose of the Lord that will stand. So our desires, our plans, even when they're not bad, they don't determine the future. They don't get to determine tomorrow. No, it's the Lord, right? It's His plans. It's His desires. It's the purpose of the Lord that determines our future. And so beware of being one of those people who attempts to self-determine his or her future. We're not given that right. Give your future to Christ. Give it over to His will. And I guarantee you this, your future will not be a failure. Give it over to Him. So now, kind of piggybacking on this a little bit, we need to understand, look, your future cannot be known. And the reason that our future cannot be known is because your life is only a mist. Your life is only a mist. It's not maybe all that we think it is sometimes. In the middle of verse 14, there's a question that all of us need to answer. Really important question, but a really kind of basic one. The question is this: what is your life? Have you ever answered that question? Have you ever given much consideration to that? What is your life? Now, of course, the answer isn't, well, my life is my business. Whatever I want it to be, whatever I decide it will be, my life belongs to me, and I'll make the most of it to make me happy and to fill my life with pleasure. That's not the answer. As the church, as a follower of Jesus, 1 Corinthians chapter 6 tells us, you are not your own, for you were bought with a price. You don't belong to you anymore. Your life is not your business. You were bought with a price. You belong to another. And since as a Christian then, you belong to Christ, what this means on one hand is really good news. It means your life is not worthless. It means that your life is not without purpose. No, you were created with purpose, absolutely, for sure. But what James reminds us here is, though you have worth and though you have purpose, this life of yours, it is fragile. And it is short. It is transient. We're here one minute and we're gone the next. These physical bodies, the ones we currently inhabit right now, they're not eternal. There's a body to come, but it's not this one. And so James adds in verse 14, for you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. In the big scheme of things, just a quick little mist and then vanishes. And so the question before us is, how then should we live? How then should we organize our lives in light of this reality? Well, I think King David gets it right. He prayed for, in light of all of this, he prayed for a more God-centered perspective on life. In Psalm 39, 4 through 6, he says, O Lord, make me know my end, and what is the measure of my days? Let me know how fleeting I am. Behold, you have made my days a few handbreadths, and my lifetime is as nothing before you. Surely all mankind stands as a mere breath. Surely a man goes about as a shadow. Surely for nothing they are in turmoil. Man heaps up wealth and does not know who will gather. And that's absolutely true, and it's absolutely right. One thing I would say is, let's, in light of the new covenant, in light of what Christ has done, let's add this Christ-centered perspective of the Apostle Paul on top of that, that we see in Galatians 2:20, where he reminds us, or he says of himself, he says, I have been crucified with Christ. And by the way, that changes everything. I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. Just a little quick summary. That means life doesn't belong to me any longer. Life is not mine. My life is in Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So how do you make the most out of a mist? How do you make the most out of a life that is a mist? Well, you do it this way. You use that mist for kingdom purposes, not for selfish, materialistic purposes, not just for personal gain. You use that mist for the glory of Christ instead of the glory of self. For you and I, it's absolutely true that our life is a mist. But it's also absolutely true that God delights in making the most out of those mists. He'll make the most out of it. Because if we'll let him, if we'll put him at the center of our plans, he'll help that mist, he'll help that whatever season of life we have, he'll help it glorify Christ. And that's how you make the most out of life. Your life is only a mist, but God can make the most out of that mist. Here's the fourth takeaway from what we see here in verse 16. Number four is your boasting in yourself is evil. If all of our planning, all of our focus is on what I can accomplish, what I can gain in life, then my boasting in myself and what I can do, what I can accomplish is evil. And in verse 16, there's a serious warning here to the so-called self-made man or self-made woman. In other words, the alternative to, say, a 1 Corinthians 31 attitude, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord, which is good and appropriate. The alternative to that is to boast in our own abilities, in our own cleverness and intellect, in our own planning, or as verse 16 puts it, boasting in your arrogance. Boasting in your arrogance. And the problem with this, verse 16 warns, is that all such boasting is evil. It's sin. All such boasting is evil. Now, again, notice what he says here. Let's be really, really clear. All such boasting is evil. Because as followers of Christ, as Christians, we should boast, believe it or not. We should boast. Not all boasting is evil. We want to boast according to 2 Corinthians 12:9, where Paul says, I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Notice who gets the glory there. We should boast according to Galatians 6:14, but far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. By all means, let's boast in that. Back in the beginning of this letter that James wrote in chapter 1, verse 9, James says, let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation in Christ. As the church of Jesus Christ, by all means, let's boast in what glorifies Christ. Let's boast in what Jesus has done for us. Let's boast in what Jesus can do for our lost family members, for our lost neighbors who desperately need to know Him. Let's boast in Christ and His cross. But church, any other boasting? Boasting in self? As if we're some kind of autonomous beings doing this thing of life on our own? James is really clear. He says, that's evil. That's arrogant boasting, and that's evil. Christian, your life is hidden with Christ. Your life is in Christ now. Let's organize our lives accordingly. Let's position our lives accordingly. So what does that look like? Well, fifthly, it looks like this. Your wisest plan is doing the Lord's will. It's what it kind of boils down to. Your wisest plan is doing the Lord's will. So how do we do this? Well, a couple of things here. First, submit your future to the Lord's will. Just a position of submission before the Lord. Position your future to the Lord's will. So verse 15 puts it this way. You ought to say, not this arrogant planning, not boasting in our arrogance, but you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. We need to be very cautious about letting our planning in life declare our independence from the Lord. Or think we can declare our independence from the Lord. James isn't saying that we need to, every time we make a plan or every time we make a suggestion, we need to verbalize this, if the Lord wills. I'd be glad to go to lunch with you if the Lord wills. I'll be glad to go home and take a nap if the Lord wills. I'll be glad to, whatever the plan is, if the Lord wills. He's not saying you need to verbalize that every single time you make a plan. But he says that must be the posture of our heart with every decision. That must be the posture of our heart. The intention of our heart needs to be to put our present and our future in such a position that it will honor the Lord. So posture your heart to the Lord's will. Submit your future to His will. But then here, secondly, don't forget then to actually obey the Lord's will. Don't forget to obey. This is where verse 17 is kind of interesting, the way it finishes out our passage here. It almost seems out of place at first. Verse 17 says, so whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him, it is sin. And so what the text is saying to us is, now you know the right thing to do. In light of what we've just seen here, it may even go back beyond previous to our passage, but now that you know the right thing to do, by all means, do it. Remember, he said earlier, James said, don't just be a hearer of the word, be a doer of the word. Now that you know the right thing to do, do it. You see, too often, one of the little flaws that we have as Christians is we like to define sin in a very narrow term. Sin becomes simply doing those things that Scripture says we ought not do. Action. It's doing what we're not supposed to do. That's absolutely true, of course, but that's not even the point here. the point is, omitting doing the wrong thing, or excuse me, omitting doing the right thing is just as sinful as doing the wrong thing. Does that make sense? It's not just doing the wrong things that is sin, omitting doing what we know. Omitting doing what is right, that's sin as well. Do you remember when Jesus in Luke chapter 19, he spoke this parable of the 10 minas? Do you remember that particular parable? He talks about this nobleman who is about to depart for a significant amount of time to a far country, and he has these 10 servants, and he gives each of them a mina. And he tells them, engage in business until I come. Now, in other words, do what you're supposed to do. You've been given instruction. You know what you're supposed to do. Well, nine out of them did what they were supposed to do and all of that. But the tenth one, remember, he takes that mina and he just kind of, he holds on to it. He hides it. And then when the nobleman comes back, he's like, here's your mina. I didn't waste it. In other words, I didn't do the wrong thing, except omitting doing what he was supposed to do was actually the wrong thing. When this servant did nothing, when he omitted doing what he knew to do, the nobleman calls him wicked, and he punishes him for that wickedness. You see, church, as we plot out the course of our weeks and our months and our years, we need to remember that we are a dependent people. We're a mist. We are a dependent people. We have been purchased by the blood of Christ, and what that means is we belong to him. We don't belong to ourselves. We belong to him. And the implication here, what I want us to see here is, because we belong to Christ, because we are now in Christ, we are his, let us submit our futures to his will. And then actively seek to obey his will, to obey his calling on our lives. You see, church, if we're going to be the kind of people who would say, you know what, I'm done playing the world's games. I'm done chasing the dreams of the world. I'm done chasing the materialism of the world and the practical atheism of the world around me. If we're going to say that I'm done playing the world's games and we're going to honor the Lord with all of our plans, we're going to need to walk away from here with some strong commitments in our heart. A commitment to being Christ-centered rather than self-centered in our plans. We need to come away with a commitment of expecting the unexpected, knowing that we can't know the future, but we know the one who does know the future. And walk accordingly, according to his will. Remember, life is short. Use yours to make an eternal impact. And then, by all means, don't forget to do what is right. Don't forget to apply the truths that we learn from God's word. Don't forget to apply what he tells us, what he communicates in his word as we pursue his will. Now, it might be this morning that for some, pursuing the Lord's will and beginning that journey and taking that first step in pursuing the Lord's will means surrendering our lives to him. It may mean that we need to take that first step of surrendering through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. Before we can seek to live a Christ-honoring life, before we can posture our hearts to follow hard after Jesus whenever, wherever, however he leads, we first need to step off the throne of our hearts, turning away from sin through repentance and trusting in Jesus Christ alone for salvation. And then the task before us is for each one of us, don't leave the Lord out of your plans. Keep your life or make your life a Christ-centered life as we seek his will and seek to walk in faithful obedience to him. Amen? Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, I thank you for the truth of your word. And as I've confessed already this morning, God, this speaks deeply to me. One of those type A, one of those organized, one of those planners in life. It's so easy to kind of get into the rhythm of life that we're used to and really just kind of leave you out of it. And Lord, I don't want that for my life, and I don't want that for any of our lives. So help us to put into practice what we know, to live the truth of our lives, which is that we are in Christ when we place our faith and trust in Him. Father, whatever our response needs to be to your word this morning, I pray that you would make it clear. For some, it may mean trusting in Jesus for the very first time, committing our lives to follow after Him. For others, it may mean taking the focus off of ourselves and putting it back on Jesus where it needs to be. Whatever that response is, I pray that you'd make that clear to us as we sing during this hymn of response. We thank you for your word in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I'd ask you to stand.